Very good afternoon to all of you. I'm Dr. Tanya Bose. Welcome you to the second session of MATLAB, an introduction with applications. Sorry for the inconvenience created in the morning due to some technical reasons. Yesterday, I received a common query from all the participants regarding MATLAB installation. Now, MATLAB is a licensed software, so it is not possible to download MATLAB from internet. Some of you might have been trying it to install MATLAB after my session or maybe before, but you more might have faced the problem of activation code. However, you might find a cracked version of MATLAB available on the net. In the Edison block of Chitkara University, there is a lab where MATLAB is installed. So once the situation gets normalized, you can practice there. Till then, you can learn the basics and keep your notes ready. In my first session, I told you about MATLAB windows, how MATLAB acts as a calculator, some of the elementary built-in functions about the variables and the script files. Yesterday, we also saw how the script files are created, saved, and executed. So let's begin with today's session. So the outline of my presentation today would be creating arrays, mathematical operations using arrays, and solving linear equations. So we start with the first section, that is how to create arrays. Now before we start creating arrays, let me tell you what are arrays. So the people who don't have a maths background, they might not be knowing what are arrays. So arrays can be classified into one-dimensional arrays or two-dimensional arrays. So an array is, it is a list of numbers which are arranged in rows and columns. The simplest array, which is one-dimensional, is a row or a column of numbers. In science and engineering, one-dimensional arrays represent vectors and two-dimensional array represent matrices. So arrays are nothing, but it is just an arrangement of numbers into rows and columns. So if there is only one row or one column, it is characterized as one-dimensional array. And if there are multiple number of rows and columns, then they are termed as matrices. Now, how do we create a vector from a known list of numbers? The vector is created by typing the elements or the numbers inside the square brackets, right? So if you remember my last slides, the yesterday's lecture, there I told you about the assignment operator. So this is how we assigned it to a variable. So we have to write a variable name, put it equal to, and then we need to insert the numbers within the square brackets, right? Now, if we are talking about one-dimensional array, that means about a row vector or a column vector, how to create those arrays? So let's talk about the row vectors first. Now, if I want to make a row vector, how will I write it? I will first put the square bracket and I will start typing the elements one by one, and I'll place either space between the elements or I will put a comma between the elements. So suppose if I want to write a row vector as 1, 2, 3. So I will write, I'll put a square bracket, I'll write 1, then space, then 2, then space, then 3, and then I will end it up with a square bracket. Or in place of space, I can also put a comma. Similarly, how do we write a column vector? Again, there are two methods of writing a column vector. You first type the left square bracket and you start writing the elements, and in between the elements, put a semicolon. This is one method. The second method is that after writing every element, you can press the enter key and then at the end put the right square bracket, and that will give you the display of a column vector. Now let's see a tutorial of creating a one-dimensional array. Now look at this data. It is a data which is telling us about the year and the corresponding population in that particular year. So suppose if I want to create the array of this data, I want the year to be displayed in the form of a row vector and I want the population to be displayed in the form of a column vector. So how will I write these data? So I have assigned the year with the symbol YR. So I'm writing YR is equal to, since I want a row vector, I'm writing a square bracket. I'm writing 2006, I'm putting a space, then 2008, then space, 2010, then space, then 2012, then space, 2014, space, 2016, space, 2018, and I'm ending it up with a square bracket, right? So when I press enter after this, this will give me the display as YR is equal to, so this is my display. So you can see that you have a row vector displayed here, right? Similarly, if I want to display the population in the form of a column vector, POP, so I'm giving the name, variable name as POP, this is equal to, I'm writing 127. To get a column vector, I need to place a semicolon between the elements. So I'm writing 127, semicolon 130, semicolon 136, semicolon 145, and so on. The last element is 211, and I'm ending it up with a square bracket, right? So when I put up, when I press enter after this, this will give me the display as a column vector, right? Now, similarly, for a row vector, in place of space, I can also put commas in between these numbers. This will also give me the same display. And likewise, in place of semicolon, after every element, I can press an enter key, and these numbers will come one by one, one below the other. And again, the display will be in the form of a column vector, right? So I think this is clear to everybody how to create a one-dimensional array using MATLAB. Next, we move on to creating a vector by specifying the first term, spacing, and the last term. So now, so if the first term is M, the spacing between the two numbers is Q, and the last term is N, it can be created by typing, write the variable name, put equal to, put square brackets, write the first term, put colon, write the space, then put colon, and then write the last term, right? So this is the format of writing a vector by specifying the first term, spacing, and the last term. Now let us look at the screenshot. You can see the first example. X is equal to square brackets 1 semicolon, sorry, colon 2 colon 13. So we can see that the first term is 1, last term is 13, and the spacing between the elements is 2. So when I press enter after this, the display will be first term is 1, the next element will be 1 plus 2, that is 3, next element will be 3 plus 2, that is 5, and so on. The last number will be 13. So they are equally spaced, and the spacing between each of the elements is 2. Likewise, look at the second example. Y is equal to square brackets 1.5 colon 0.1 colon 2.1. When I press enter after this, my display shows this as my row vector. So here the spacing is in decimal. So there is a spacing of 0.1 between each element. Look at the third example. Z is equal to minus 3 colon 7. So what is missing here? In this, minus 3 means the first term and 7 means the last term. That means the spacing is missing here. So if the spacing is missing here, MATLAB takes the default as 1, right? So what it will do, it will add 1 to each of the numbers. So minus 3 plus 1, minus 2, minus 2 plus 1, minus 1, minus 1 plus 1, 0. Likewise, it will go on till the last number is. So if the spacing is omitted, by default, it will be taken as 1. Look at the last example. A is equal to 21 colon minus 3 colon 6. So spacing here is negative. So spacing can be positive as well as negative. So if this is a negative spacing, we will get a decreasing order. So the first term will be 21. The last term will be 6 and the spacing between each element will be minus 3, right? So this is an example of getting a vector with specifying its first term, the spacing and the last term. Now, how to create a vector with linear spacing by specifying the first term, last term and number of terms. So in the last slide, we saw that how to get the vector by specifying the space between them. Now we will generate the vector with the help of number of terms, right? So here, what is the format? Suppose the first term is A, the last term is B, and the space, and we need n elements between them, and all the elements should be linearly spaced. In that case, the format used is put a variable name equal to linspace A, B, n. So A becomes the first term, B becomes the second term, and n becomes the number of terms. So you should remember these commands because in the last one, we were using colon. Now we are using commas, right? Look at the screenshot now. Look at the first example. VB is equal to linspace 30, 10, 11. So this shows that I need 11 terms between 30 and 10. So the first term is 30, the last term is 10, and it needs to generate 11 elements between them. So you can see the output. 30 is my first term, the last term is 10, and in between you can count them, they are 11 elements, right? Okay. Now look at the next one. U is equal to linspace 49.5, 0.5. So what is missing? There are only two characters written here. So 49.5 is the first term, 0.5 is the last term. That means the number of terms are missing. So if the number of terms are missing, by default, MATLAB will take it as 100. So when I press enter after this, you can see that there are 100 elements generated till here. So, and the spacing between them, they are equally spaced and they are 100 in number, right? So in the last slide, we saw that if the spacing was not given, it will be taken by default as 1. In this slide, we have seen that if the number of elements are missing, by default, it will be taken as 100. Clear? Okay. Next. Now, how to create a two-dimensional array, that is a matrix. So to create a two-dimensional array, we need to type the elements. We need to give them some row number and column numbers, right? So a matrix is created by assigning the elements of the matrix, first of all, to a variable. And then they are done by typing the elements row by row inside a square brackets. And all the rows must have the same number of elements. The dimensions of every row should be same. So this is the format of typing the numbers in a matrix. So give the variable name, put equal to, put a square bracket, then type in the first row elements. While you are typing the first row elements, how will you write them? You will write them one by one, either by putting a space between them or by putting a comma between them, right? When the first row finishes off, put a semicolon sign, then write the second row elements, then again a semicolon, third row elements. Likewise, we move on to the last row elements, right? Okay. Now look at this example. I have assigned the variable A equal to, I want my matrix to be generated in this form. So I can see the first row is 5, 35 and 43. So I'm writing it as 5 space 35 space 43. I'm putting a semicolon so that MATLAB knows that my first row has ended here. Then I will write the elements of the second row. So it is 4 space 76 space 81. Then I'll put a semicolon. Then the third one, 21 space 32 space 40, and I end it up with a square bracket. When I press enter after this, I will get my output in the form of a matrix, which is a 3x3 matrix, right? Look at the second example. I want my matrix to be generated in this form. So you can see that there are 3 rows and there are 5 columns here. So how to generate? B is equal to I'm starting the left square bracket. I'm writing the elements of the first row, 7, 2, 76, 33, 8. Then I've pressed enter. Then I'm writing 1, 98, 6, 25, 6. I'm pressing enter. 5, 54, 68, 9, 0. And I've ended up the square bracket. And when I press enter after this, I will get this as my display. So I told you to generate matrices also like we were generating a column vector. Either you can place semicolon after every row or you can press enter after every row. So there are two ways of generating a matrix, right? Okay. Next. Now what about these commands, zeros, ones and I commands? So these are inbuilt functions in MATLAB. Now what are the meanings of these three commands? Now zeros m comma n means it will generate a matrix with m number of rows and n number of columns, and all the entries in this matrix will be equal to zero. So that is why it has been named as zeros. So in maths also we term this matrix as a null matrix, right? Then what will ones m comma n do? Ones m comma n will create a matrix with m number of rows and n number of columns, and all the entries in this matrix will be 1. So zeros will have all the entries as zeros and ones will have all the entries as 1. And the third command, IN, this will create a square matrix of the order n cross n, that means there are n rows and n columns, and in the diagonal places the entries will be 1. And all the non-diagonal places, the entries will be 0. So it is similar to an identity matrix. So it will create an identity matrix of order n, right? So let's go to the screenshot. Look at the first one, zero command. I am assigning the variable ZR equal to zeros 2 comma 3. So it will generate a matrix with order 2 cross 3. So there are 2 rows and 3 columns and all the entries in the matrix are 0, right? Next, I'm assigning the variable ON for the matrix ones 3 comma 2. So there are 3 rows and 2 columns and all the entries in this matrix will be equal to 1. The third one, I command. I will generate, so I'm assigning the variable as IDN. IDN is equal to I and then in brackets I'm writing 2. So it will generate a square matrix of order 2. And in the diagonal positions, you will get 1. In the non-diagonal positions, you will get 0. Right? So these are the roles of zeros, ones and I command. Okay. Next is the transpose operator. Now we know that what is a transpose operator? Transpose operator means switching a row to a column or switching a column to a row. Let's go to this example. The variable AA is equal to 381. 381 will generate a row vector with these three elements. When I assign BB is equal to AA transpose, this is nothing but the symbol of quotation mark in your keyboard. So when I press enter after this, you can see that this row vector has been switched to a column vector. So this is the role of transpose operator, right? Okay. Next is array addressing in one dimensional arrays. Now what do you mean by the address? Address means the position of that element in that particular vector. So to mark the position, the format is VK. V means the name of the vector and K means its position. So if I address a vector, if I call out a vector V equal to 1, 2, 3, so the first place is 1, the second place is 2 and the third place is 3. So if I want to call any element of that vector, I will do it with the help of this command, right? Okay, let's see. Look at this example. First of all, I'm defining this vector, V is equal to 35, 46, 78, 23, 5, 14, 81, 3 and 55. So this is a row vector. Now suppose I want to call the fourth element of this vector, V4. Fourth place means 1, 2, 3, 4, 23. So when I press enter after this, what is my output? My output is 23. Clear? Okay. Now we can do simple mathematical calculus also using these array addressing. So you can see that I've written V2 plus V8. So what will it do? The elements at the second and the eighth position will get added. So 46 will get added with the eighth position. So eighth position is 3. So 46 plus 3 will give you the answer as 49. Right? Look at the next expression. V5 raised to the power V8 plus square root V7. So if you remember my last lecture, we did order of preference there. So in order of preference, parentheses are solved first. So this part will be solved first. V7. V7 means 81. So square root of 81 is 9. Then the next preference is given to exponential functions. V5. What is V5? V5 is 5. Raised to power V8. V8 is 3. So 5 raised to power 3, 125. 125 plus 9, that will give me the answer as 134. So simple mathematical expressions can also be done with the help of array addressing. Right? Okay. Now, what about array addressing in a two-dimensional array? So in a two-dimensional array, of course, we have to give its row number also and the column number also. So if M marks the matrix and K will mark the row number and P will mark the column number. So for a vector, we just need its position. But for addressing a two-dimensional array, we need to give its row number as well as the column number. So check the screenshot. First of all, I'm defining a matrix, a 3 cross 4 matrix. So when I press enter after this line, I will get the display as this as my matrix. So you can see there are 3 rows and 4 columns in this matrix, right? Now, suppose I want to know which is my third row first column element. So I am writing it as M3, 1. So third row is this one. And the first column, this is my first column. So the intersection comes out to be 13. So when I press enter after this, my answer will be 13, right? Okay. Likewise, I can also assign a new value to this element. Now, if I write M3, 1 is equal to 20. Previously, this position was allocated with 13. Now, if I'm writing it equal to 20, that means this 13 will be replaced with the number 20. And then when I press enter, it will change the matrix. This place will be changed to 20. Rest all the positions will remain same. Right? So this is how you assign a new element to a matrix. And then again, we can do simple calculations like I'm writing M2, 4 minus M1, 2. That means the element at the second row, fourth column should be subtracted from first row, second column. So second row, fourth column is 2. First row, second column is 11. So 2 minus 11 is minus 9, right? So this is how we do it in two-dimensional arrays. Next. Now, we can also use a colon symbol while addressing arrays. So first we will study how to do it in one dimension and then we will extend it to a two-dimensional array. Now, a colon can be used to address a range of elements in a vector or a matrix. So, if I give the format V and in round brackets I put a colon sign, what does it mean? V means the name of the variable, which is the vector has been assigned. And when I put colon, it will display all the elements of that vector, right? And when I write Vm colon n, it will only refer to the elements m through n of the vector v. Let's see the example. Look at the first one. First of all, I'm creating the vector v. So you can see after pressing enter, this will be my display. Now if I write, now here I'm assigning a vector u as v3:7. So what will 3:7 do? It will only display the elements from the third to the seventh column of that vector. So the third one is 3 and the seventh one is 50. So it will display the elements from 8 to 50. So m is to n means it will display the elements from the mth position towards the nth position, right? Okay. Now, how to address a two-dimensional array using a colon? Now, for a matrix, A, if I write in a round bracket, first of all, I'm putting a colon sign, then I'm putting comma, and then I'm putting n. This refers to the elements in column n. So it will generate the elements of the nth column. If I write an, comma, colon, it will generate the elements of the nth row. So if the column number is mentioned, if you remember the address of an array, the first position is for row and the second position is for column. So if I write the column number here, it will display the elements of the column. And if I write the row number, it will display the elements of the row. Now what about A? In the first position, I'm writing colon. Then I'm writing m:n, right? So what it will do? Here it will display the elements in all the rows between these two columns, between the columns m to n. Likewise, m:n, comma, colon. It will refer to all the elements of all the columns between these two row numbers, that is between the row numbers m and n. And if I mix these two commands, the new command generated is m:n, comma, p:q. So it will refer to the elements in row m through n and columns p through q. So it will display the elements of m:n in the rows and p to q in the columns, the intersection of all these rows and columns, right? So let's understand these commands with the help of the screenshot. So you can see that I have defined a matrix A and it has 5 rows and it has 6 columns, right? So it is a 5x6 matrix. Now, in the second command, I'm writing v is equal to a. So I'm assigning a vector b. This is equal to a. I'm putting a colon and I'm writing comma 3. So what it will do, since the column number is mentioned, it will display the column third, right? So this is my column third. So check the output. My answer is 5, 6, 9, 12, and 50, right? Look at the second one. C is equal to A, 2, comma, colon. So now what is happening? I'm mentioning the row number. So it will generate the elements of the second row. So this is my second row, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So this is displayed here, right? Okay. Next, same matrix I'm defining here. Look at this example. E is equal to A, 2:4, comma, colon. So what was the meaning of this? That it will create a matrix E and it will generate the rows from 2 to 4. Since the row number is mentioned here, so it will mention all the elements of the second row to the fourth row. So the second row is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Third row, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18. Fourth row, 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, and 24. So these elements will be generated in the matrix E. Then look at this example. I'm assigning F equal to A, 1:3, comma, 2:4. So it will generate all the elements between the row numbers 1 and 3 and between the column numbers 2 and 4. So let's check row numbers 1, 2, 3 and column numbers 2, 3, 4. So what is the common intersection between them? These are the common intersection elements, right? So we will get 3, 5, 7, 4, 6, 8, 6, 9, and 12, right? So this is how we use colons to address a two-dimensional array. We move to the second section of my presentation, that is mathematical operations with arrays. Now, how do we add elements to a matrix? Look at this example. First of all, I'm creating a matrix A, and the order of the matrix is 2 cross 4, 2 rows and 4 columns. Now, suppose if I want to add a row here, right? So what? How am I doing it? I'm writing A 3 comma colon is equal to 10 colon 4 colon 22. If you remember my first slides of today, we did this command. So this will generate a vector with the first element 10, the last element 22, and the spacing between them will be 4. So when I press enter, the matrix A is generated. So you can see the first two rows remain same. The third row has been added. The row starts from 10, ends at 22, and the spacing between them is 4, right? So this is how I have added a vector to the third row of the matrix A. Now, if I suppose want to append two matrices together, suppose I want to append this matrix A with another matrix, let me define this matrix with identity. So we did this command before. So we assigned B is equal to I3. So I3 means an identity matrix of order 3. So on the diagonal positions, we have 1. And on the non-diagonal positions, we have 0. Now suppose if I want to append this matrix A with B here, what will I do? See, I've written C is equal to A space B. So when I take the output, the elements of A are listed first, then it is appended with the elements of B, right? So in this, we have to take care of the dimensions of the two matrices. The number of rows in both the vectors should be same. Otherwise, this won't work. It will give you an error, right? Okay. Next is some built-in functions for handling these arrays. Now, the first built-in function is length A. Length A returns the number of elements in the vector A. So, look at this example. A is equal to 5924. If I give the command length of A, how many numbers are there in this vector? There are 4. So, my answer is 4. Size A. This returns a row vector m, n, where m denotes the row number and n denotes the column. So you can check this. A is equal to 614012 semicolon 4959968 and 2. So when I write size A, it will give me the answer that it has 2 rows and it has 5 columns, right? The next built-in function is reshape A m comma n. It will create a m cross n matrix from the elements of A, and the elements are taken column after column, right? Let's look at this example. A is equal to 516 semicolon 802. When I press enter, what will my output be? The output will be like this. 516 in the first row, 802 in the second row. Now, if I assign a new matrix B as reshape A, and I want 3 rows and 2 columns. Here, what is the order? 2 cross 3. So, there are 2 rows and 3 columns here. Now, I want to reshape it from the elements of the same matrix, but I need 3 rows and 2 columns. So, what it will do? It will take the elements column after column. So, we will start from the first column. It will write 5, 8. Till here, I got 2 rows. Now it needs another row. So it will move on to the next one. It will take 1 from there. And then it will place 0, 6 and 2 in the next column. So column by column, the elements will be taken. But then again, we have to take care of the dimensions. the dimensions of this matrix A and this dimension should match. So if it is a 3 cross 2 matrix or a 2 cross 3 matrix, that means there are 6 elements here. So whatever reshaping I'm doing here, I should also have the same number of elements. I cannot write here as 3 comma 3. 3 comma 3 means it will generate 9 elements, which it will not be able to do, because in the matrix A there are only 6 elements, right? So this is what reshape does. Next is diagonal V. So for diagonal V, have D-I-A-G. Diagonal V means when V is a vector, it creates a square matrix with the elements of V in the diagonal. So suppose V is 7, 4 and 2, and if I give the matrix name as A equal to diag V, it will generate a matrix where the diagonal positions would be 7, 4 and 2, and in the non-diagonal entries, the elements would be 0, right? Okay. The next one is diag A. When A is a matrix, it creates a vector from the diagonal elements of A. So here, A is a matrix with the first row as 1, 2, 3, second row as 4, 5, 6, third row as 7, 8 and 9. So VEC is the name of the vector that I want to generate. VEC is equal to diagonal A. So what it will do, it will just take the diagonal entries from here and it will give you the display as 1, 5 and 9. That means when diagonal command is operated on a vector, it generates a matrix. And when diagonal command is operated on a matrix, it will generate a vector. Right? Okay. Next is how to do mathematical operations with arrays. First, we will see how to do addition and subtraction. Now, addition and subtraction, for that, you can see that I've defined, first of all, the two vectors, vector A and vector B. Next, I'm defining addition of two vectors as vector C is equal to vector A plus vector B. So this is quite easy. The addition is done element by element. 8 and 10 gets added, 5 and 2 gets added, 4 and 7 gets added, right? Likewise, you can also do the same thing with the help of matrix also. So I've defined two matrices A and B having the order 2 cross 3, and then I'm defining C is equal to A minus B. So here the two matrix will get subtracted element by element. So you can check that these will be the entries in the matrix C. Likewise, we have added two matrices, D is equal to A plus B. Again, the elements will get added one by one, element by element. The next command, vect A plus 4. In vect A plus 4, what is happening is that there is a scalar addition to this vector A. So what happens in scalar addition? In vector A, in all the elements, the vector, the number 4 will be added. So here 8 plus 4 will give you 12, 5 plus 4 will give you 9, 4 plus 4 will give you 8, right? Likewise, we can do the same thing in matrix also. Subtract scalar 5 from A. So A minus 5 is, so from every element of the matrix A, 5 will be subtracted. So you will get 0, minus 8, 3, 4, minus 3 and 5. Right? Okay. Next. So to keep in mind, the ones who are not in from maths background, when we are adding and subtracting the matrices or we are doing it in vectors, the dimensions of the matrices and the vectors should be same. Right? Now, how to do mathematical operations with arrays? The mathematical operation now we will study is multiplication. Look at the screenshot. First of all, I'm defining a 4 cross 3 matrix. This is my 4 cross 3 matrix. And then I'm also defining the matrix B. And the order of the matrix is 3 cross 2. Now, one thing I want to tell you that whenever we are multiplying two matrices, the column number of the first matrix should be equal to the row number of the second matrix, right? So, column number of the first matrix should be equal to the row number of the second matrix. So, when I multiply C is equal to A into B, these two matrices will get multiplied and the output generated is this. And when the output is generated, you can see what is the order. It is 4 cross 2. So 4 was left from here and 2 was left from here. So the order of C would be 4 cross 2. Right? Now check one thing. I am writing the next command. D is equal to B into A. What is MATLAB giving me? It is telling me error using star. Inner matrix dimensions must agree. Can anybody think why cannot we multiply B and A? I just told you that the column number of B should be equal to the row number of A. So column number of B is 2 and the row number of A is 4. So they are not equal. So we cannot multiply B with A. Though we could multiply A with B. Right? So here MATLAB will generate an error. Right? So these dimensions must be kept in mind while we are multiplying two arrays. Okay. Next is inverse and the determinant of a matrix. Look at the screenshot. First of all, I'm creating the matrix A. This is my matrix A. Now I want to calculate the inverse of this matrix. So I'm using the command INV of A and I'm assigning it to the matrix B. So just with the help of a click, I get my answer to the inverse, right? Otherwise, if you do manually, we need to calculate the adjoint, we need to calculate the determinant, and then we need to put it in a formula, then we get the value of the inverse. So just with the help of one click, we get my answer to the inverse, right? Now, if this is my matrix A and B is the inverse of this matrix, so when I multiply A and B, what should be my answer? It should give me an identity matrix. So I'm checking it. So see A into B, it gives me an identity matrix, right? So this was about inverse. Next is determinant of this matrix A. So for determinant, we need to put the symbol command DET and you write the name of the matrix for what you want to calculate the determinant. When you press enter, your answer is 2. So the determinant of this matrix would be 2, right? We move on to the last section, that is solving linear equations. We have a system of linear equations. There are 3 equations with 3 variables which we need to calculate, x, y, and z. So my first step is to convert the system into a system of arrays, right? So how we are doing it? First of all, from these equations, we are calculating the coefficient matrix. The first row tells me that the coefficient of x is 4, the coefficient of y is minus 2, the coefficient of z is 6. So I'm writing them in the first row. Likewise, I'm writing the coefficients of the second and the third linear equations in the second and the third row. So this has been put in a square bracket. Then I'm writing the next column vector as the system of variables that we need to determine in this problem. So we need to calculate the values of x, y, z. So I'm writing it here. And then I'm writing it equal to the right-hand side vector, that is 8, 4, and 0. So we are writing here 8, 4, and 0, right? Let's name it. This is my matrix A, this is my matrix X, and this is my matrix B. So I need to calculate X. So what will I do? I will pre-multiply with A inverse on both sides. When I pre-multiply A inverse, this side A inverse into A will become identity. Identity into X will give me X. And on the right-hand side, I get A inverse into B, right? Now let's see how it is solved in MATLAB. First, I need to define my coefficient matrix, that is matrix A. So you can see I have defined it. Then I have defined my matrix B like this. This also we have done how to define it. Next, we need to calculate X. So I'm writing X is inverse of A into B. When I press enter, I get the values of my unknown variables, right? So you can see it's so simple. With the help of a click, you get the answer to the unknown variables. Otherwise, you have to invest 10 to 15 minutes to get the answer to this variable, unknown variables, right? Okay. Now, there is also another command of writing inverse of A. You can also use the symbol front slash. In your keyboard, you will find two slashes. One is front slash and the other one is backslash. So you have to use front slash here. So you have to write X is equal to A front slash B. So this will also give you the same output. So in place of inverse of A into B, you can write A front slash B, right? Okay. Now we have some more built-in functions. Mean A. Mean A returns the mean value of the elements of vector A. So if I have the vector 5924, it will add up all the elements and divide it by 4. So it is 20, sum is 20, sum 20 by 4, the answer is 5. Max A, it returns the largest element of the vector A. So in this vector, 11 is the largest element, so max A is equal to 11. Min A, it will return the smallest element of the vector A. So min A in this vector will be 2, right? We have some more built-in functions. Sum A, it returns the sum of the elements of vector A. So here the sum of this element vector A is 20. Sort A, it arranges the elements of the vectors in ascending order. So A is equal to, so it will arrange all these elements in ascending order. That means from smallest to the largest element. So the display is 2, 4, 5, and 9. Median of A, it returns the median value of the elements of vector A. Now what is the median value? It means the middlemost element. So if your elements are odd in number, it can pick up the middle element. But if they are even in number, you will get two middle positions. So the mean is taken there, right? So this is my vector. If I want to calculate the median, I can find that the length of this vector is 4, so it is even. First of all, I need to arrange them in an ascending order or in a descending order. So I will get 2, 4, 5, 9. So the two middle elements are 4 and 5. So there are two middle elements. I'll take their mean. So 4 plus 5 divided by 2 will give me the answer as 4.5, right? Okay. Now I'll take a problem of electrical resistive network analysis and we will see how MATLAB is used to solve these problems. So you can see there is a circuit shown in the problem and you need to determine the current in each resistor using the Kirchhoff's voltage law. So the voltages are given to you. There are 3 voltage drops across the circuit and there are 8 resistances in this circuit. So the values are given. You need to calculate the values of the current I1, I2, I3 and I4. Let's see how to solve it using MATLAB. So let me build in the problem first. So we need to create the logics first and then we will go to the problem. Now for this circuit, I need to develop the equations related to every circuit that is present here. So look at this diagram. So you can see that across the resistance R1, current I1 is flowing. Across the resistance R2, I1 is flowing in this direction, I2 is flowing in this direction. Across resistance R3, I1 is in this direction, I3 is in this direction. Across R4, currents I3 and I2 are flowing. Across R5, only I2 is flowing. Across R6, I3 and I4 are flowing. Across R7, I2 and I4 are flowing. And across R8, only I4 is flowing, right? So according to the Kirchhoff's law, voltage drop across any circuit is equal to the sum of the potential drop across all the resistances, right? So let me apply the Kirchhoff's law to the first circuit, that is this one, this which is containing R1, R2 and R3. So I start from the positive sign. So we write V1 is equal to I1 R1 plus this is the direction. Now I move here. So it is R3 into I1 minus I3 plus R2 into I1 minus I2, right? Now let me move on to the second circuit. This is my second circuit. So in this second circuit, there is no voltage drop. So the potential drop across all the resistance will be equal to zero. So you can see that if I go in this direction, I2 into R5 plus I2 minus I1 into R2 plus I2 minus I3 into R4 plus I2 minus I4 into R7. This is equal to zero. So we get the second equation. Third equation. Let's move on to the third circuit, which is containing voltage drop V2. So we move from plus towards the minus sign. So in this direction, I will go now anti-clockwise. R3 into I1 minus I3 plus R4 into I2 minus I3 plus R6 into I4 minus I3. This is equal to V2. So I get my third equation. And finally, I apply the Kirchhoff's law to the fourth circuit here. So moving in from plus to the minus sign, I4 into R8 plus I4 minus I2 into R7 plus I4 minus I3 into R6 is equal to V3, right? So we get the fourth equation. So on my right hand side, I have V1, 0, V2 and V3. Let's frame these equations in the form of the unknowns. So I have to place the coefficient first of I1, then I2, then I3 and then I4. So after certain manipulations, the four equations can be rewritten in the matrix form in this way, right? So you can check this. And now, so this is the rough calculations of my problem, of my circuit problem. Now I will design the program and let's see how to get the output, the values of I1, I2, I3, I4 using MATLAB. So if you remember my yesterday's lecture, we did script files. So this was the editor window that we were working with. So now how to write this program. So in the first line, I'm writing the values of V1, V2 and V3, all the voltage drops, right? Then in the second line, I'm mentioning all the values of the resistances starting from R1 to R8. And if you remember, the symbol of percentage was just for commenting. So this is used for commenting purposes. And then the third line, I'm writing matrix A equal to. So if I go back to my last slide, this is my coefficient matrix A. So I'm writing the entries row by row. The first row is this one. So I'm writing the entry here. Minus R1 plus R2 plus R3, then R2, R3, 0, semicolon, the second row elements, third row elements, and the fourth row elements, right? Then I'm defining the matrix B as my right-hand side vector. So it is minus V1, 0, V2 and minus V3, right? And then I want to calculate the values of the current. So I is inverse of A into B. So we can also write inverse of A into B as A front slash B. Now after writing the script file, I will save this file. And then when I run this file, what is the output show? The output will be shown like this. It will display the coefficient matrix A. It will display the right hand side vector. And then it will display the value of the unknowns, that is the values of I1, I2, I3 and I4. this is what we wanted at the end. So these are the values of I1, I2, I3 and I4. So this is how MATLAB is used to calculate electrical resistive network analysis, right? So it becomes very simple to use MATLAB to solve these linear equations. So that would be all for today. Thank you for your queries. You can drop your mails to tanya.bose@chitkara.edu.in. So we end the session. I hope you understood. So see you tomorrow at the same, sorry, not at the same time this time. We will meet at 11 o'clock in the morning. Till then, stay at home and stay safe and take care. Thank you.
Yeah. 11 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock.